And thank you for having us at the Blockchain Africa Conference. We're really excited to be speaking here and telling you a little bit more about the Presidio principles. So today I'm joined by the head of Blockchain, Digital Assets and Data Policy at the World Economic Forum, Sheila Warren. Sheila, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me. It's so great to be here.
And we're going to be running you through a little bit about the background and context and content of the Presidio principles, which are designed to be a type of blockchain bill of rights or foundational values for a decentralized future. So we'll have some slides to kind of accompany us, but this will be more of a fireside chat to get Sheila's perspective as she's been involved in the development from, you know, start to finish, which it's not truly finished, as you'll find out, but really seeing the whole process through. So Sheila, why don't I turn it over to you to give a little bit of background and where this idea originated from and how we started the development of the Presidio principles.
Sure. Thanks, Sumedha. So I think it's important to note that when I came to the forum and I started the blockchain team here, I was really focused on an ethical underpinning of the technology. And as I observed more and more disparity in who was generating wealth using cryptocurrencies, for example, Bitcoin specifically, I became a little concerned about the fact that we weren't necessarily creating a more inclusive future. We were perhaps creating a more stratified society. So that was kind of an underlying philosophy I brought to the table. But the principles themselves came out of the first meeting of our Global Blockchain Council. So it was an inaugural group of more than 30 leaders we pulled together in the spring of 2019. And we met in our offices in the Presidio, hence the eventual name, the Presidio Principles. Here you see some of the organizations and the co-chairs of that group. And this was a group that was specifically constructed or curated to have very, very passionate opinions, but very different opinions. They reflect institutions, different protocol, some who were blockchain skeptics. You know, there were really a wide variety of perspectives in the room. But the one thing we agreed on over the course of the day we spent together in this spring of 2019 was this concept that there did need to be some sort of framework for an ethical application layer. So not that we were looking at the protocols themselves, the Bitcoin blockchain or Ethereum or whatever it might be underlying, but that we were really exploring the idea that a lot of the value of building on top of these protocols came about from the decentralization that the protocols provided. And that many applications, by contrast, were being built in a more and more centralized manner. So how did we ensure that there was an openness, a transparency around what was happening, and a way to almost check that the application layer reflected the underlying principles that were inherent in the protocols themselves? So that's sort of the origin story, if you will, of the principles.
Great. And yeah, you can see here that it was quite a diverse group of people. So maybe I'll ask you to give us a bit of a peek behind the curtain. What was the process of developing these principles with such a diverse group?
Well, you know, so again, you know, there wasn't much this group agreed on, I must say. There were some very strong views about all kinds of things, but it was pretty clear instantly that there were just some sort of philosophical underpinnings to that what brought us all together and why all of us were so passionate in our own way and with our own, you know, agendas, quite frankly, around the technology. So we started off by really brainstorming, like, what should this focus on? And initially, it was kind of funny because everything came back to GDPR and data. You know, we realized that, oh, we're kind of accidentally just rewriting some of the sort of data privacy principles or even parts of GDPR and porting them over. And that doesn't really make sense because those obviously laws and regulations already exist. And there's no need to kind of point out some of the places where they intersect isn't really a great use of this group's brain power. So we shifted away from that to this focus on the application layer and thinking about what are the higher level, almost, how do we order almost some of the approach to the space and to the build of applications in a way that's going to provide this sort of check and balance approach to whether or not applications are truly realizing the potential of the technology?
Great. And I think that's a good transition to take us over to the content of the principles. So I'll move over in just a second, but just as a background, the pillars, the principles are organized into four pillars. So we'll talk about that in just a minute, but there are 16 principles overall. So we'll show you the first half of the principles here. And Sheila, curious to hear a little bit more about why we started with this group of principles and the two pillars of transparency and accessibility, as well as agency and interoperability.
Yeah, so I'll note that I think these two were the, in some ways, the easier two to land on. There was pretty widespread understanding that transparency was part of the promise of blockchain. And one thing I'd been saying even back then, you know, was that transparency is not really meaningful without some sort of accessibility that provides it to it. So, you know, I'm a former lawyer, and we're very familiar as lawyers with this concept of a data dump, where, you know, your opposing counsel asks for information and you ship over, okay, you want information? You know, here you go. But it's impossible to kind of get through all the information to find that, as we say here in the States, the needle in the haystack that's going to actually provide value. So I thought it was really important, and the group agreed that transparency alone was not going to be sufficient, but it was getting most of the airtime in the space. So adding in this concept of accessibility, making the information meaningful, making sure that people could comprehend it and understand it and know kind of what they might want to do with it was very important. So from there, it led to the four principles that you see here, and the bucket here kind of created itself around the concept of right to information about the system itself. Now, we also wanted to be clear that we weren't expecting any application providers, you know, to sort of do a massive blockchain 101, you know, education on the technology. It was more, you know, what do you have access to and where is it? So that if you're so inclined as a user to go in and really kick the tires, you can. And then so you understand a little bit how the service is using blockchain technology. So we were worried a bit here about what we called blockchain washing, the idea that somebody might use a blockchain, really centralize away, you know, or code away a lot of the benefits potentially of the technology, and build something that kind of had one tentacle, if you will, into a blockchain, but wasn't really based on a blockchain in any meaningful way. So it's kind of the understanding that that needed to be something that was more transparent to people, and they understood, you know, what that meant. And then similarly for agency interoperability, you know, unsurprisingly, the blockchain ecosystem, particularly at that time, was very full of sort of crypto libertarians, if you will. And so the idea of self-custody or, you know, self-management or ownership of data was quite important. Now, I think it's really important to pause here for a moment and say that our intention was never that every single application built be able to adhere to every single one of these principles. And for that reason, they are not, you know, you're not legally bound by these when you sign on to the principles. It's really more assess each of these 16 principles and make a decision about which of these apply to your service and which don't. So here you see there's differences, for example, in number 5 around some of the custodial services, for example, right? That might, 5 might not be relevant here. The idea that you could independently store your keys. Also, there are differences here with maybe enterprise systems, you know, private architecture versus public blockchains, which we acknowledge as well. And so again, it's nothing that's bad or wrong about doing one way or the other. It's that there's acknowledgement of which one you're doing and why and kind of what the implications are. But again, this concept of agency interoperability was something that with lots of more technically minded folks in the room, the idea that there wouldn't be vendor lock-in, that would basically create a centralized walled garden, which is antithetical to what a blockchain ecosystem is trying to do. So this concept again was pretty straightforward. And then of course there was hot debate over even the word choice on some of these things. And Sumedha, you well know that we did have many, many rounds of feedback that we got on all these principles down to the literal words that we were using, the order of them, you know, what the implications were of putting 6 ahead of 7, for example. I mean, that wasn't actually an example, but you know, whatever it might be. Transparency was in the top left quadrant, agency in the top right quadrant of one page. And what does that mean? And all of this stuff was hotly, hotly debated, down to even the little icons that you see in the corner and what the implications there were. So I don't by any means mean to say any of this was easy, but I do think landing on these two broad themes was relatively straightforward compared to some of the other work that we had to do to get the Presidio principles launched.
Yeah, absolutely. And we, just to add to that, we got feedback from all sorts of places. So I think this is one of the only documents that has been workshopped at the World Economic Forum's annual meeting in Davos and also on GitHub. So that kind of shows you the range that's seen this document and was privy to putting some of the input into the principles as you see them today. And so with that, we'll kind of move on to the next set of principles. So these are the rest of the 16. So Sheila, I'll turn it back over to you to walk us through privacy and security and accountability and governance.
Yeah, so surprisingly, these were a little bit more controversial because I think there's with privacy, the question always becomes, what is private by whom and from whom, right? So who has access to see what and what is protected and what does that mean? So the idea here also was, what are the consequences? These are a bit more about consequences. So if, you know, your privacy is breached, however that's designated, you know, then what happens? And that's a complicated question. Similarly with accountability, the idea here was, well, should there be a defined method of recourse if something happens? You know, how do you do that? Different blockchains have different protocol around that. There's different mechanisms for doing that. In some cases, it's really kind of too bad. You know, there isn't really recourse. So how do you think about that? And so here, you know, this is number 15, you'll see here was where we acknowledge where we began, which was the kind of, well, we can't violate GDPR and relevant law. So here we said, look, I mean, there may be instances where people make their own choices about build, but it needs to be very clear, you know, what is in compliance and in compliance with what, and what might be in compliance and might not be in compliance at a certain given moment in time. What to be waiting for approval from a regulatory authority? Some of these questions I think that came up, we handled in the way we structured number 15. And then similarly, we were very worried about the kind of revenge posting context. You know, somebody wants to post something about another person and it's kind of immutably recorded. Would there be some opportunity to correct that? That's just one very, very minor and narrow example of kind of a broader problem of false or inaccurate or misleading data. And so the idea here was, obviously on a blockchain, it's immutable, but what recourse would you have to basically correct the record to ensure that what was necessary was actually completed? So this was that's a more challenging section. These two sections were more challenging, I would say, just because here you get into a lot of very heated discussion from all over, you know, from the old days of the internet around like what should be public, what should not be, what should be protected, what shouldn't be. Some principles here I think are pretty clear. Number 12 is really de-anonymization, the idea that you really shouldn't, you know, collect data. That's just a best practice that we all sort of are familiar with. Don't take it if you're not going to use it because it's only going to get you in trouble. And that's kind of on both sides of the equation. But also there was this question around, what should the standard be? Should we hold applications on a blockchain to the very, very highest standards or the standards that are inherent to the protocol? And so what you'll see is that we punted, frankly, a bit here. And we said each blockchain protocol and consensus mechanism has its own mechanisms for kind of ensuring security. Applications are leveraging those. So it goes back to kind of the first set of principles. To the extent that that's not happening, there should be notice about that, that there is a difference in the way security is managed that may not be what you expect if you're building into, I don't know, the Ethereum blockchain or whatever it might be. You might have a certain, you know, the brand carries at this point a certain kind of expectation. And if you're not adhering to that, we think that you should at a minimum be, you know, adhering to some sort of objective standard and be clear about what that is. So again, here, you know, wordsmithing happened a lot all the way down to, you know, what the placement of these various things and which kind of went where. But at the end of the day, you know, we were able through a very rigorous review process and a very lengthy review process that Smitha well knows of, she carried it out to get to consensus and agreement on these 16 foundational principles.
Great. And so while we're here, just going to pitch you some questions that we've gotten from people who are looking at the principles. So what happens, and you started to touch on this, if organizations can't meet all 16 of the principles, can they still sign on? What's the point of something like this if it's not easily attainable for every blockchain application?
Yeah, these are really meant to be, you know, a North Star, kind of a guidepost. And so this is sort of our ideal version of what a blockchain application would be able to do. But as I mentioned, we do not expect, in fact, we think it's very unusual and maybe very unlikely that an application would meet all 16 of these, you know, to their core, right? Like maybe they would touch on some of them, but every application is going to focus more probably on one of the boxes of the four kind of big thematic areas more than the other ones because of what they're trying to do. So if you have, you know, a file sharing protocol, it's going to focus a lot on things around data disclosure, protection, things like that, you know, more than something that may be focused on even like, I don't know, NFTs, for example, right? It's a different kind of thing. The mechanisms and the approach is different, and the weighting of these principles should be reflected accordingly. So again, there is no expectation that all 16 are closely adhered to. What we are requiring of signatories is a consideration of all 16, an evaluation of which ones are priority, and to some extent a disclosure of the fact that you have been through this process. You bed it into your design sprints or into your QA, or if you're assuming you're in that flame, we actually have a whole set of guidebooks on what kind of actor you are in the ecosystem and how you might use the principles. It's very robust. So if you're a funder, you might have, you know, checkpoints on the principles. If you're a builder, you might have QA or sprints designed around them. If you're a journalist, you might be questioning, you know, about the principles and ask how a particular application is looking at the principles. And there are a lot of different kinds of ways you can engage with them. So yeah, absolutely not necessary that you be, there's no strict scrutiny, as we say in the law here, you know, no one's coming to slap your hand. They're really meant to be a function that really helps the ecosystem remain true to its roots, which is something that we're all inherently motivated, fortunately, to do. And so I think the incentives are well aligned.
Yeah, that's great. And a great transition, I think, to hearing a little more from you about how organizations can kind of move from aspiration to action. So what are some of the things that organizations can do right now as they think about and evaluate the Presidio principles within their operations?
Yeah, well, so first of all, I think they're just resources for signatories. So we really ensure you to, and we really encourage you rather to publicize that you've signed on to protect user rights. And that's really what this represents, is that you are putting user rights front and center in your activities and in your approach to blockchain technology and to what you are focusing on in the entire ecosystem. And so the idea here is that you can have your team sign on. If you're, you know, a founder or something like that, and you sign on, you can individually sign on in addition to having your organization sign on. We have suggestions for what do you do with these principles? Like, what do you literally do? And so I touched on some of these, you know, if you're a funder, what you might do, if you're a builder, what you might do, et cetera. We also have just ideas about how to share with your community to say, like, this is important. We are surfacing user rights. We're centering them, you know, and we think they're critically important to the ecosystem. We encourage you to do the same and sort of make a movement around this that we think could be very, very powerful. We also have guidance documents. And the most significant one here is the Ethereum Foundation, which issued a guidance document that really gives specifics on technical, operational, governance, you know, different kinds of guidance for how you implement these principles. And it looks across different verticals and ecosystems, and it's quite robust and precise. And so if you are building in the Ethereum ecosystem, I highly recommend you consult that document, because it provides guidance from some of the experts in the space, those who are working at the moment, you know, on ETH2. So it really does help provide, again, this sort of consistent, you know, call to action across the entire ecosystem, which we think is so needed and important.
Great. And so we hope you'll not only sign on, but take a look at some of these resources and actually put them into practice in your organization. And on that note, I'd love to hear a little bit more about the impact and what you've seen out of organizations that are already signed on and who's signed on.
Yeah, so I think we have a really strong list here of some of our early signatories, and they have been very supportive of this, and, you know, in terms of their speaking publicly about it and how they're engaging with it. And I think that you can see just the sheer variety of organizations here. We have public sector institutions like the Presidency of Colombia. We've got, you know, startups. We have the World Food Program. We have coalitions. And we have Andreessen Horowitz, which is a major funder. Accenture and Deloitte, some major advisors. You know, CoinShares, which just went public and just IPO'd. So we've got a lot of different organizations here that are signing on across the entire ecosystem. And what we're seeing is that they are actively embedding this into their considerations. So when faced between the choice of funding A or B, they bring forth the principles and say, you know, how are you adhering to these? How are you putting user rights central? How are you, because the user rights centricity, I think, is a proxy for building out the ecosystem. And we're still in the adolescence of this technology in a way that, you know, it really matters, right? Like if we get the more sort of Mt. Gox type activity we get, you know, it's bad for the entire ecosystem. So it's really important to those who are putting a lot of blood, sweat, and tears and cold, hard cash funding, you know, whether that's crypto or other kinds of funding into the ecosystem, to make sure that the ecosystem is very strong. So we're seeing that. We're also seeing this be, again, a proxy, like an indicator to users that user rights, their rights are being considered. You know, so it may not be that everyone's going to GitHub and doing a lot of the sort of literal democratic, you know, gathering of feedback, but this helps ensure that those perspectives are taken into consideration and they're taken into consideration along the way. So they're a benchmark, you know, they provide, again, a sort of standard, like a touch point. And you kind of know that everyone who signed on to this is oriented in the same direction. And there's a community, I think, evolving around this of people saying, here's how we're using it, here's how we're using it. Are you using it? Because we feel like that means that we are probably allies in some way, even if we are also literally competitors.
Great. So we're almost at time, but to end and to close this out, we'd love to hear a little bit more about what's next. What can the audience here today do or take action related to the Presidio principles?
Well, here I'd love to flag and highlight your work, Samantha, because we are in the process of rolling out a brand new website that's going to make it even easier to access the principles. We welcome you to this QR code. You can just kind of wave your phone. We'll enable you to sign up the principles yourselves. And we really welcome that. You know, we are very responsive to being tagged on Twitter about the Presidio principles. We track the hashtag. So we are very happy to see when people have signed on to this, particularly in geographies where we haven't necessarily made major pushes. We're very happy to see, you know, what you're doing with them. And so we think those case studies are really powerful. So we do collect those case studies, and we actually have a booklet that we're creating around how people are using this in action. And then of course, there's the kind of the A plus, you know, version, which is actually developing a guidance document. So the example we showed you was the Ethereum Foundation, but kind of saying, you know, how are you doing this and what advice do you have for others? This is particularly true if you are, you know, head of a coalition or if you are a funder, you know, kind of indicating here's what we expect to see. Here are the ways we're using it. If you are a member of our coalition, whatever that might be, here's what we encourage you to do, or here's what we are kind of checking against when we check in with you on the principles. So a lot of different ways to get involved with the community. But it all starts by reading through them, signing on, and making that known. So we really welcome your engagement, and we're so grateful to you for your time today.
Yes, and if you have any follow-up questions or ideas for us, you can reach us at blockchain@weforum.org. And we check that email especially closely for Presidio Principles content. So welcome you to reach out to us anytime with ideas or questions. So thank you so much, Sheila, for walking us through this. And thank you all for listening. And we hope you have a great rest of the conference and great rest of your day.